He will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the laws. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member is to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is July 6, 2016, and we are back after the 4th of July holiday that is known to many as, well, I guess it's known to everybody as Independence Day, although I don't know what independence that I got, but I guess at the time they did get independence from England, sort of. I guess if you go through history, did they really? But anyway, thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're coming live to you from Las Vegas, Nevada. We're on weekends, weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. And you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. And to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, and SoundCloud. And the next day on Stitcher. And we are now also on iTunes. I guess we've been on iTunes a while. We were originally on iTunes on Blog Talk Radio, and I went to make sure the hookup was, or the files were flowing through, and they are. So you can get us on iTunes. So that's good. I still don't know how to figure out how many people listened, but it's there. So at least we're there on iTunes now. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty and self-ownership, meaning being able to do whatever you want, as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force, based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. Sorry about that. I don't know where my head's at today. It's kind of the first day back after a long weekend. And then yesterday I was off as well and just went to sleep because on the 4th of July we had went to the 51s game, which is the AAA team. And I was up a little later than usual and then just passed out after work yesterday. But we are happy to hear from you via phone at 702-470-7664 or via Skype at Nonpartisan Liberty for All is the username. And you can just send a contact request with your name and what you want to talk about. And check us out on NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, which has links to our Facebook and other social media, as well as all the contact info, archives that I post every weekend, as well as original articles and blogs. As I have mentioned, I'm still working on a series on the legalization of drugs and why they shouldn't go back to how they were before the 1920s, where they were just like anything else where you could purchase in any store, essentially. You could purchase them in the Sears catalog. I'd also like to mention, if you missed the 4th of July show of the Illumination Hour, you can, of course, catch that on any of our applications where our archives are posted. And, of course, you can get all the links to those at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. Spreaker is our main one, so you can get it there. But you can get it in a number of other places that I mentioned that the beginning of the show. And again, if you want to get a list of those, go to NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. I wanted to also mention that for tomorrow's show, I am planning on, really for the first time, talking about corrupt cops. And I know what everyone's going to say. Well, you talk about corrupt cops all the time. You talk about cops that do all these things and violate rights and things like that. Now, I think there is a difference between corrupt cops, and I'm talking about cops that deal drugs, cops that protect drug dealers, things like this, and rights violations, that cops that go out and harass people, violate their rights. There's a line, I think, that's kind of blurred there, where you can go from a cop that violates people's freedoms and does something that kind of blurs that line. Or you can do both. I mean, you can violate people's freedoms and be a cop that sells drugs. We have with us today, who he's been away for a while, as he had a pool tournament the last time he was supposed to appear, which I guess he did pretty good in, but did not win, Ken Schortgen. So since I have Ken with me, I'll bring him in this very short discussion, because we'll be, I'll be discussing it tomorrow. Ken, it's nice to have you back.
Evening, Dave, and pleasure to be here as usual.
So just because I have you with me, and I'm kind of setting up the show for tomorrow as a little teaser for everybody, what is your opinion on that? So I kind of separate cops in that you have, and mostly what I've talked about on the show is more about cops that violate people's rights, you know, cops that are like, I got arrested by cops that were just fucking with me, where they gave me bullshit charges that they knew weren't going to even stick. But then they get to harass me and throw me in jail for the night. I actually didn't really go to jail. I kind of just sat in this room watching TV with a bunch of other people waiting to get bailed out. But they know, you know, I got to sit there for 12 hours, bail myself out, which was $3,000. Took me a month to get my bail back. It never even went to court. I mean, the DA said, this is ridiculous. And not surprising that that even happened. I mean, that's how ridiculous the charges were. But you have cops like that, and, you know, that beat people up, that shoot people, rights violations, cops that abuse people, cops that abuse their power. Now, they're still abusing their power if they're dealing drugs, obviously, but it seems like the corrupt cops, quote unquote, are the ones that they actually care about going after, and the cops that beat people up and shoot them and violate their people's rights, they really don't give a fuck. So it's kind of different in that sense, and I kind of classify them into different categories. And I had seen this documentary on a New York cop in the 17. It was called the 175. I don't know if you've seen it. It was about a cop named Michael Dowd. It was mainly about him, but it was about the precinct in general. And in the precinct right next to theirs, closest to theirs, the 177, they had an issue there around the same time as well, where like 10 cops went to jail or something like that. So these were cops that were doing things like that. Like, he talked about, yeah, I was getting paid from a drug dealer to protect them, to tip them off. I started buying cocaine and having somebody sell it for me. So what are your thoughts just briefly on, do you see a big difference there, or do you just lump them all together like these are just all a bunch of fucked up cops? And is it – well, let me get the answer to that first, and then I want to ask you one more question before we move on.
No, I think you have to do the opposite, is you can't lump everybody into the same, because, you know, there's a lot of – one, you can't – I don't think of them as cops. I think of them as humans, and people – are from all shades of life. You know, there are those who started out good, but say they work in narcotics and they're surrounded, you know, there's a rookie, they get an old veteran who maybe takes some money from drug busts on the side and trains a good, you know, rookie cop to this is how it is, and then they become that. You know, they evolve into it. You also have in
that,
a lot
that's
of,
what he, not to interrupt, but that's what he had seen, and most cops see that as well, that at least have come out and talked about after going to jail that how it started for them is exactly kind of how you said, that they saw older cops and the attitudes of older cops, and they let them know right away, like, hey, you snitch on a cop, you know, you're getting fucked up. He had mentioned in an interview that one cop who snitched on other cops, he ended up falling over a railing five floors up and dying. And the whole thing, he was like, well, how the fuck do you fall over a railing? You know, hinting at, okay, you know, somebody killed this guy over snitching on cops. Like, they take that shit very seriously.
Right. And then of course, you have the cops who wanted to be public service, but their city managers or the city council or the police chief tells them that they have quotas. And so to fill their quota, they have to harass people, give tickets when they shouldn't, they normally wouldn't. And it's not that they want to do it. It's that if they want to keep their job, then they sort of have to. So you get those who are just, you know, they're followers. They're following the system. Then, of course, you have the opposite end of the thing. You've heard of the Oath Keepers, haven't you?
Yeah, I have. Actually, it's funny you bring that up, because there's also LEAP, which is Law Enforcement Against Prohibition, meaning law enforcement that is for the legalization of drugs. And I'm going to have somebody on next Tuesday. He's scheduled to come on. Hopefully we'll be able to meet that date. But if not, we'll set up another date. But yeah, there's also LEAP as well. But yes, I've heard of the Oath Keepers also, who are more of a constitutional. I actually heard the head of the Oath Keepers speak before, to be honest.
And the thing about it is the Oath Keepers, it's not just military, but they go around talking to law enforcement, and they get a number of law enforcement to sign up saying, we will promise to support our oath and protect the rights of the people and protect property.
But they're more constitutional than anything.
Well, true, but they're still a segment of the police have dedicated themselves.
Most of them, though, are retired. That's the whole thing. Even with LEAP, not all of them, but the majority of those, both of those organizations, are retired, because it's hard to be in one of those organizations and be on the job still. Because, like I said, I mean, if these people are saying that, yeah, essentially, whether they come out and say it or not, they're saying that, yeah, if a cop, another cop, violated somebody's constitutional rights, I'm going to speak out about it. Right. And they don't like that.
But the point is that Oath Keepers, I don't know much about LEAP, but Oath Keepers, it would be pointless if everybody was retired. No, they have tens of thousands that are both in military and law enforcement.
The military, yeah, there's more military that are actually
law
active.
Law enforcement is a big thing. Now, you also have a fourth segment that are forced by – see, this is something else too. Power – corruption starts at the top and usually works its way down. It usually doesn't start at the bottom and work its way up. Let's take a look at what just happened with Hillary Clinton and James Comey at the head of the FBI. The head of the FBI broke seven. He admitted her failings in dealing with classified material. He broke seven statutes to not indict her. And right there, the guy is corrupt. He was either bought off, he was scared to death, because if you know the history of the Clintons, if you cross them, then more often than not, you end up like Webb Hubble, dying because they can't get his heart medication in a prison cell, or Vince Foster, suicided in a park that nobody knew about, or of course Ron Brown, mysteriously the aircraft blows up. So that's the thing about it is you do not cross the Clintons. Bill may be out of office, but their power stretches all through. And one of the reasons that also that it wasn't that they didn't get indicted is because Bill and Hillary have all the dirt on everybody in Washington and they've already made the she already came out, or at least her sycophants or spokespeople came out and said that if Hillary doesn't get the nomination or if she gets indicted, one of the two, that she's going to reveal everything about everybody in Washington. So everybody's scared to death. It's all fear. Now, James Comey, when he was the second district attorney, I think, of the region of Atlanta, Georgia. I think it was Georgia. He put a well-known and famous economist in prison with no charges for 7 years. Under a contempt of court ruling, Martin Armstrong, you may have heard that name. He's well known for his economic models that have, pretty much come out to be true. Anyway, they did a contempt of court and threw him in prison for 7 years. No charges, no indictment, no nothing. James Comey was the prosecuting attorney in that case. James Comey also was in charge of putting Martha Stewart under for insider trading. She didn't do insider trading. She just lied to the prosecutor about the information she got, but it wasn't insider trading. So James Comey is a well-known and well-established guy who picks and chooses who gets indicted. Now, see, this is what I'm saying about the cops.
But is that something that everybody else doesn't do? Not that I'm saying it's okay that he does it, but
they're all
corrupt. But
the point I'm saying is that it's like if you had computer problems and you called up Microsoft, okay, and you get somebody on customer service, whether they're from India or not, doesn't matter. Those at the lowest level of customer service, you should know as well as I do, they don't know anything. Or a bank teller.
Yes, can I help you?
You don't know anything. And then when you try to go to their manager, they don't know anything. And finally, somewhere up at the top, somebody knows something.
Right.
And somebody has the power to do something. Well, that's the same thing with cops. The cops are limited in their scope. They have certain powers and that. But they are limited in what they can do based on, the upper chain of the bureaucracy. Well, if the top leadership in law enforcement is corrupt, okay, then that's going to trickle down all the way.
No doubt.
And
it comes from the top.
All we see are the cops. And we only see the DA if we're actually in court. But for the most part, we never see these guys who are making the rules, making the policies, picking and choosing who gets indicted, who doesn't. A poor guy who gets for drug possession, but he didn't hurt anybody, they don't care. Because that guy can't afford a real lawyer to get him off. It's the system is built on justice for the rich.
Yeah, and
imprisonment for the poor.
You make a good point that I've brought this up before, that everybody gets mad at the police, which justly so, because they're still making the decision to stay in that job. But at the same time, no one's blaming the politician that made the stupid fucking law, or nobody's blaming the judge, or nobody's blaming the district attorney. I mean, some people are, but the majority of people are just blaming the police. They're not looking at the whole hierarchy there, where it's coming from as well. So it's something where you can't. I agree with blaming it on the police, but at the same time, you got to blame it on the politicians. You got to blame it on the judges. You got to blame it on the district attorneys. Some more blame than the actual police. Because, like you're saying, I mean, you're only seeing the police part of it. They're still a tool of the system because they're following those orders. They could leave and say, "I don't want to do this."
Okay.
I want to get another job.
Let me give an example that they could leave. You remember the Baltimore riots shortly after the Ferguson ones, where somebody in Baltimore was killed. The uproar by the Black Lives Matter and the protesters who were shipped in from the Soros paid group, they were so vehement. Plus the fact that you had a black district attorney and a black police chief who didn't stand up for the cops, okay?
I don't think the cops deserve.
And so what do the cops do? What do the cops do? Well, in the ghetto areas and the high crime areas, they stopped going in. And crime shot up 60% in 2 weeks. Okay? So We can remove the cops and the cops can quit. But guess what? It's going to be a war zone. That is the biggest example of what happens if there's not any type of law enforcement presence. I'm not saying that those cops or cops in general are good, bad, or what, indifferent.
Well, they're when you say human. Crime, what crimes are we talking about?
Murder, drugs.
Drugs, I wouldn't it count as crime, but murder, you know, if the murder rate went up or rape or things like that, that's definitely
assault, violence.
An issue, but I'd have to see the, you know, whatever. But yeah, but still, you know, that's a whole nother story.
The point I'm making in all of this, okay, is that if you want to fix the problem, you fix the problem at the top. You don't fix the problem at the bottom.
Right.
And all, you know, I am for whenever a police officer does something against the Constitution, against the law, or uses their power beyond the scope of what they're supposed to, by all means, publicly excoriate them all across the web, all across the news, all across this. But you can't – if you want to solve the problem, you can't do it by blaming the cops. You can only do it by looking up the chain and seeing by the fact that is the lieutenant – are the lieutenants condoning their behavior? If that is, then the problem is there. Is the police chief condoning the behavior? Does the police chief only go public when all of a sudden there's a public outrage? Or does the police chief actually try to do something to reform the system?
Well, and I don't know that you can reform the system. I think it's the institution.
You can reform the system.
It's the institution, and it's always going to be that way. And you need to get rid of the institution itself. Let me tell you something.
There's a reason why. There's a parallel in many things between police officers and military. Okay, it's a highly stressful job where you're putting your life on the line. You don't know You don't know if you're some whacked out fool who's got pulled over for a traffic violation.
That's
going to shoot you.
That's a fallacy. That's like saying, you know, the chances of and the amount of times that happened. It's not even ranked in the top 15 most dangerous jobs. That's not. An actual statement that the police are always in danger. Certain area, if you work in a certain area, you know, you're going to have definitely a higher chance. But you even look at the amount of police that are murdered. It's very, very low. It's tiny. Now, they want to bring up the amount of police that die on the job because it's a lot higher, but most of them are dying in car accidents. I think last year it was about 39 or 40 police that actually were killed by somebody.
Right, but the point is very low. The point behind this is, okay, if you really want to look for the problem, then you've got to filter the statistics extremely fine, okay? Most of the people whose lives are on the line are ones who work either undercover, narcotics, something like that. If you're a homicide detective, nobody's going after you because you're coming after the fact and it's long gone. Okay, you may chase down a perpetrator who killed somebody, but chances are most perpetrators aren't going to, you know, they're on the run. They're not trying to take out a cop or something.
I don't know what
but narcotics, you walk into a situation, especially if you're undercover. Here's something else about
If drugs were legal, you wouldn't have a narcotics.
But there's more than just drugs.
So
okay, we're dealing with a time in history where we're talking, you know, explosives, terrorism, you name it, okay? Undercover goes...
Which is being totally
like the mafia. Like the mafia with, forced prostitution, human trafficking.
Human trafficking is an issue. However, there's reasons why, like illegal prostitution being illegal. No one's looking at the root of the problem. It's just, well, this is an issue, and this is an issue, and it's just like, well, narcotics police. Well, there wouldn't be narcotics police if drugs were legal. There wouldn't be, or there'd be a less amount of forced, you know. Forced prostitution, if prostitution was legal, if immigration was dealt with differently. That's, I mean, if those two issues right there are what's making human trafficking what it is. You take those out of it, then that drops to basically nothing. And that has nothing to do with police getting killed, in my opinion.
But you can't
it's mostly
that.
Patrolmen anyway.
You can't change those philosophies, those beliefs, those laws at the policeman level.
No, that's true.
You have to change them up. And this
but
is
that's
why
not
going to
happen.
Okay. Then nothing
and
changes.
And that
so
is the problem.
But
the reason it's not going to happen, it's not bitching about it. It's telling the facts that bottom line is, in my opinion, that the only way to change anything is by noncompliance and self-defense and defending yourself against government agents. And I've said it, and I'll say it over and over again. That it's not true, because if everybody did it, then, you know, you're not going to see police violating rights as much.
But most people won't do it.
The getting rid of, that's why you shouldn't have an organization that has rights that regular people don't have. So I don't want to get on a whole thing with this. I mean, really, I just wanted to promote tomorrow. And really, my question was just the difference between you have cops that violate people's rights and cops that are corrupt. And, you know,
so there's no other cops
how you look at that.
There's other
cops,
I'm not talking about that.
I'm talking about what I focused on the show. Why am I going to focus on, you know, and I believe that all cops are bad because they're all kidnappers. Because anybody that arrests someone for having a substance on them that they have the right, as far as I'm concerned, to consume is a kidnapper.
There's
but
more crimes.
That's a whole other issue. But there are – what I was saying is that I've talked about cops that beat people and violate their rights is what I'm saying.
Okay.
And I haven't really talked about cops that are more – breaking law. I mean, they break laws, the ones that violate people's rights, but that there's a, you know, if you lump just, are those just all bad cops, or these are a special kind of bad cop compared to another kind of special bad cop, and or is one worse than the other? Because people could say that they are. That the drug dealer cop is worse than a cop that just beats people up and, you know, shoots somebody when they shouldn't and whatever. And I think it depends, but it's probably the other way around. I don't know. It's something I got to think more about. So that's really all I was asking with that, is that you do have cops that they're not drug dealers. They don't actually commit what we would think of as quote unquote crimes, but they violate people's rights. And then you have cops that actually, they may or may not violate people's rights, but they actually commit crimes that they rob. I mean, they were talking about cops that were breaking into people's houses and robbing them. This cop had done that. He had sold drugs. He had, you know, all of these things. And even talking about having that power, it wasn't just about the fact that, you know, other cops did it and things like that. But having that power, you're like, hey, I can get away with anything. I'm fucking invincible. I'm a cop. And that was part of it, the power thing, the knowing that you can get away with it. So it was just a kind of teaser for tomorrow's show, saying, you know, how you compare – you know, a cop that actually is breaking what we would call the current laws, even though I don't agree with them, and becoming a criminal themselves, and a cop that we might still call a criminal, but he's a criminal because he's violating people's rights, which may or may not even be criminals' rights that he's breaking. So that's what I was kind of talking about. So... I don't know. I'll just give you the last word on that, and then we can move on. A brief word.
Like I said,
what you think about the main topic. I understand the other stuff, and it comes from the top and whatever. But I mean, it just the difference there, and is there a I mean, is there a psychological difference? Is there, do you look at them differently?
Look, I'm one who believes this. It's all human nature. Whether it's cops, politicians, whether it's city managers, whether it's IT professionals, there's good apples, there's bad apples, and then there's apples that are in the middle that can be swayed either way. If you can find in your local neighborhood, you know, good, friendly, honest cops that you can cultivate a relationship with, those are the ones you stick with. The ones who are corrupt, guess what? And this is my whole point about it. And this is something to take in consideration. Yes, information is important, but if it has no application, then it's simply a rant. And people get tired of rants in the long run. What you got to do is you got to find where is the problem, lay it out, and then say, where's the solution? The solution is getting masses of people going to city council meetings and threatening the mayor and the city board, we're going to vote you out, and we're going to put in some other people, and they're going to get rid of the police chief, and they're going to reform this whole thing. Okay, or we're going to remove the laws in this local area, and then we're going to take it up to state level. Will people stand up and do it? I can't answer that.
And that's fine.
Historically, they don't.
But I can't talk about the same thing every night, and I need to mix things up, and people need to know about there are cops that are doing different types of things. There are cops that are corrupt that are criminals, and there are cops that are corrupt that are just beating people up and whatever.
And there are cops who are just trying to do the best they can.
You know, so I need to also inform people that, look, this is going on too. It's not just cops beating people up. Yes, it comes from the top, and I've talked about that before as well. And like I said, I mean, people should be mad at every form of government or every level of government, but definitely because they're all complicit in it. It doesn't matter what level you're at. You can't excuse, well, you're at the bottom level, or you're in the, you know, middle or level, or you're, even though, yes, it does come from the top, but if you're on any of those other levels, you can get out of them. So anyway, tomorrow I will be talking about the documentary and a couple of other cops that were actual criminals, and talk about the more criminal side where we haven't really talked about that and where that comes from. And Ken had some good points where it does come from other cops and it comes from the system and things like that. And we'll talk about that. So,
hey, let me bring one last thing. You know, there was a great example. It's one of the most recognized literature books in American history. It's To Kill a Mockingbird.
I've read the book, yes.
Okay. You know, it was about a black guy.
I think I saw the movie, too.
Yeah, uneducated, and he was accused of, I think, raping or killing a white woman. And
Atticus Finch.
Yeah, he was the attorney. Lawyer. Yeah. But all the cops that they brought in evidence, all the people they brought in to speak, all lied.
Yeah.
Because of the racism.
That wasn't
the time,
based on a true story, was it? I mean, basically, no. That's happened. What happened in that book, I'm sure, has happened tons of times. But, I mean, it wasn't based on an actual true story, right?
But the point was is that the cops didn't just follow what the upper echelon told them to. The whole community was that way.
But
and
they
so the
didn't
cops
have
followed what
to.
The community.
But look, it's like Serbico, what he did. And he stood up and he said, fuck this, I'm going to go against the system.
Yeah. How many Serbicos are there?
There's none. There's only one Serbico. But I mean, there's been
because
other guys
human,
who have come out.
It's human
but,
nature.
Right. You know, but what I'm saying is that, yes, you need to blame really the upper. There's so many things and people that are more culpable. I get what you're saying, but what I'm saying is that still doesn't excuse them from what they do. It's just people need to also realize that there's so many people behind them at higher levels or other levels. It could just be their supervisor. It could be the police chief. It could be the mayor.
Or it could be the governor of Arkansas.
Right.
Who one time had his state patrolman shuttle in
bringing
women.
Bringing cocaine?
Shuttle in women for that the governor raped. And by the way, everybody should know the governor was Bill Clinton. So the state troopers were culpable to the governor under his, they could quit.
Yes, they were accessories.
Sure, they could quit. Yeah. But also, when Bill Clinton was helping the Bush family smuggling drugs through MENA Airport,
right.
They were involved in that.
He was a big part of that he was in the meetings of how we're going to do this. And he was one of the guys with Oliver North and George Bush, I believe, the older Bush, he was in meetings with all of them. And that's what one of the guys actually came out and blew the whistle on that because he didn't want to be involved in it. And, of course, they charged him with crimes. They tried to defame him. So same thing. I mean, people can be that person, but yeah, I mean, it's going to destroy their whole life at certain levels.
The thing about it is, though, like you were saying, if you're, if you're a good cop and things are going bad, you can always quit. Well, yeah, but what kind of job is there out there? We're not exactly in a great economy, and they pay cops well. Pensions, retirement, the benefits, all that.
Then you're
kind of hard to give up. Yeah, you do sell out. But you know what? People sell out all the time.
Well, I don't.
Why would you work in Wall Street for one of these major banks that is absolutely fraudulent, manipulates? In 2008, they destroyed $5 trillion worth of people's retirements.
Those people, all the foreclosures as well.
But there were, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Is it goes to the entire extent of human. The human heart and the human will. If you think about it, the cops who are dirty and the cops who are bad, if they weren't cops, what would they be? They'd be criminals.
A lot of them, though, are attracted to that job and have the, when they do personality tests, would actually be criminals, not because of they would have nothing else to do, but that's like the type of personalities that they have. A lot of them are sociopaths, and that's why they end up cops in the first place. So there's a lot of things that go into it. But yeah, I mean, it's not just police. But we're talking about, I do a show three times a week.
Yeah,
I gotta narrow down a topic and talk about.
I'd like to know. I'd like to hear the percentages though, because there's about 350,000 municipal and state police and local policemen. I wonder how many of them, one, have been caught, indicted, and found.
Well,
two have actually, done something like.
You never know how many have done something because so many get away with it. So yeah, number one,
the
there's no way.
It, but I'd like a ballpark figure.
I think all of them at least fucking do things they shouldn't do because they all treat people. The majority, about 90-something% of them, treat people like shit. So it's attitude. It's the fucking, and you're trained that way. And you could say, well, it's the system trains them that way. So
I would say that it's not all of them, but it's my opinion versus your opinion. And so that's sort of a losing debate to begin with.
Right. But I at least my opinion is based off of, I have a lot of information that I have a logical opinion that I base it on. And
that's why I asked for this.
Along with experience. And I know I've had more experience with cops than you have, unfortunately.
You give me some good statistics, and I'll come over to your camp.
The problem is that same with the government. I mean, so many things we're not going to get because they're not going to tell us. And so many cops are going to get away with shit. We're not going to know. But it's just based on guys that have been that receive medals and they're considered good cops and the things that they have done, or it, it's
Look, I was in the military for 7-8 years. I know exactly what you're talking about. The military kept all of their stuff in-house. There was discrimination.
I don't think the military there was racism. As bad as the police because
– When the big thing came out of rapes at the academy.
Well, yeah, that's,
got into the news. Come out. That's true. My gosh, you would think that the whole, you know, but it's a small percentage. If it gets out to the news, just like you're saying with the cops, if the stuff with the cops gets out to the news, then you know it's not just a one time event. It's probably the one event out of 10 or 20 that slipped through the cracks and got made public. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but the military is huge, and I don't think that 50% of the military or anything close to that is doing that. I mean, maybe it's 5%, maybe it's 10% at the most.
A lot of the military today are not American citizens. They're foreigners that they get signed up to go to stay overseas and fight in Afghanistan and Iraq. They sign them up in the U.S. military just like they did in Vietnam. And what they do is they promise them citizenship if they serve their thing. The other thing is how many instances did a kid who was in trouble go before the judge and say, you know, you got a choice, join the military or go to jail?
Yeah, that's pretty fucked up. Those aren't the people you want in the military, but
well, the judges are doing that because one, the prisons are so filled up.
I know two, why they do it. I know somebody that they did it to.
Yeah, well, secondly, it gets them completely out of their jurisdiction.
I had an old roommate that's pretty much what they did, and I think some judges think it will do them some good and straighten them out. I mean, they usually don't do it. They're obviously not doing it with like murderers. They're doing it with people that get in that's do stupid
car
shit
and stuff like that.
Minor stuff that is bad enough to go to jail for, but it's not that bad. So they think maybe it will straighten them out or something like that. So anyway, I know we haven't had you on for a while now, and there's a lot of things that have been going on. One that concerns me the most, yes, and gold in how gold and silver is now over $20. The current price on silver is $20.42 on gold, at least. The price that Amaji Metal showing, it's showing I got 1382 right now on showing on Amaji Metals.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I'm showing right now for the Asia markets, it's at 1369. High of 1376. But this is different. See, the one I look at is normally the futures. There's two different things. There's the physical market and then there's the futures market. So when you hear the term spot price, that's the paper price for futures contracts in September. The futures price. What they expect to, if you want to go to the commodities exchange and say you want to buy half a ton of gold. Okay, you'd buy a number of different contracts to equate that half a ton of gold. You would buy a futures contract, the future being not this month, but say September, and you would buy it at a locked-in price right now. If you were to buy it $13.69, it would be delivered to you in September. That spot price is part of the London Gold Fix that they do each day, and they do that because they need to protect the dollar and they need to protect the paper derivatives market. Now, the physical market, what you are talking about with Amaji Metals, that is a purely physical market, and that is more regional. So,
well, that's not their price. That's right. What they're showing as the spot price.
Gotcha.
So it just might be timing or something when they updated.
It was pretty interesting. I was there in Vegas, obviously, shooting in a pool tournament for our nationals and our association. And we played at 5 p.m. on Thursday, and Britain opens up their markets around midnight. They're about 7 hours off from New York time. So they were opening up about midnight, but they were opening up the polls about 3 hours before that, so about 9 o'clock. So when I got home, You know, they were coming out with the voting, and I turned on the news, and it was just insane. And when the Brexit vote came in, that they were going to, that it was going to leave the European Union, the British pound went down from 145 to 134. It was at its lowest point against the dollar in 31 years.
Last I heard, it's 131, but I don't remember when I heard that.
And I'll mention why that's extended over. But it was, that was the lowest point in 31 years against the dollar. The euro dropped 500 basis points. It went from 114 down to 108, 115 to 108. The gold in the futures market instantly shot up $100. $100 for one event. Now, they were able to eventually pull it back some, but
they went back up.
Yeah, it's what, as of today, it's past its post-Brexit highs.
And silver went way up, because even after that, it was still at like 17 or 18. Now it's over $20.
Yeah, interesting about silver. Silver shot to about 1850, but 1850 was a strong resistance point. So over the next few days, as it came back, silver has gone to over 20.
Yeah, it's showing 20.40 right now.
Yeah, last Thursday, last Friday, it went up $1.75 on those two, combined those 2 days. So silver has broken through its resistance levels, two of them, 1850 and then 20, I think it's about 2012, with the two resistance levels. It stayed up. They've tried to break it back, but it just keeps going through. So the expectations right now are, and I've already made a prediction late last month. I said gold will surpass 1400 by the end of July. There's a good chance it's going to do that. And then I believe silver, we're going to see, I think before the end of July, we're going to see a day when silver goes up between $3 and $5 in one shot, one day. The reason why is because there are over 330,000 short contracts. And you're going to see a margin call. And when that happens and they have to start covering, then you're going to see gold or silver shoot up $3 to $5 in one day. And I think it's going to happen very, very soon.
And once that happens, I mean, it, has gold reached, and silver as well, have they reached a point where you will never see them below where they're at?
Oh, you'll probably, if there's a pullback and any, nothing, just remember this, nothing ever goes up straight, a straight line. There's always consolidation, and there's what is called filling the gaps, okay? A lot of times what you'll do is you'll have a big rush in for gold that overwhelms the people selling, okay? The number of people selling at a certain price and those who buy gold and force the price up real fast, there's a gap in between those two. You have to wait until the gap is filled. Once the gap is filled and the sellers and buyers sort of reach an equilibrium again, that's when you move up.
Okay.
So it shoots up on days when there's just like a fear, you know, if there's something going, there's news that comes out that a bank failure is coming. Gold will shoot up because the algorithms will run it, and then it's a fear trade. So a bunch of people get in. Usually that's faster than people can sell and supply the buyers, okay? Because one of the things about gold and silver right now is that the actual supply is incredibly short.
Yeah, it's been that way. I know with the – and isn't this illegal that their own laws say they can't do this? But they couldn't print any silver coins, the U.S. Mint, for a while last year. They got to the point where they were sold out.
Yeah, and see – The law, which actually Ron Paul got passed under the Reagan administration, that it was the argument of, hey, if we're not going to back our currency in gold and silver, then the public should be able to buy it.
Okay. Right.
And then they passed it, whatever. The law says that the mint has to supply to keep up with demand, period.
Right.
Don't have the supply from the miners and refiners, then they have to go on the open market and buy it.
Right, you had mentioned that before, and yeah. They didn't do that.
They're not doing
they?
That. And they're not doing that under the Obama administration. That's the first president not to do it. Because the two Treasury secretaries, Timothy Geithner, who used to run the New York Fed, and Jack Lew, who's just, you know, he is a globalist and part of the cabal. No, they know because of the record sales. You know, they could have 2.5 million ounces of silver ready to go. It's bought by the bullion dealers in hours. 2.5 million coins doesn't even last half a day. So here's the problem. If they started buying back in the open market to fill the quota and supply the bullion dealers, well, they are going against their own agenda of protecting the dollar and protecting, you know, the trillions in derivatives that are tied to the commodities and tied to the dollar. See, they use the dollar for what's called a carry trade. This is one of the Wall Street mechanisms to skim money off the market for doing nothing. Carry trade is this. All currencies are not equal, right? So if the dollar is strong and the Japanese yen is weak, and the interest rate on Japanese bonds is say 3%. It's not. They're negative, but say they were 3%. What banks would do is they would take dollars and buy yen, and then they would take that yen and buy Japanese bonds. And because of the arbitrage between the dollar and the yen, they'd make a mint, you know, changing currencies and buying bonds in a different currency. And that was what was known as the carry trade. Well, after the Japanese started doing quantitative easing and started lowering interest rates to below, you know, zero, and their bonds started just falling through the floor, then the U.S. started using the Chinese yuan, the RMB, as a carry trade. But China is a little bit, you know, smarter than the Japanese, and they're not the Japanese are vassal state of the U.S. anyway. So, but the Chinese, what they did is they started manipulating their currency. Whenever you hear the government or the pundits on there, oh, China's manipulating its currency, blah blah. No, they're modifying their currency up or down to protect against the U.S. destroying their bond market in this carry trade. Everything that is dire and detrimental in the financial system comes out of Wall Street and so the U.S. government.
Does that mean that because if their currency got too high that the U.S. would buy their bonds up?
Well, what it does is the carry trade, what they do is they – see, when you want to expand your money supply, what you do is you issue a bond, like a treasury bond, U.S. treasury bond. Right. You sell that treasury bond to the Fed prints up money out of nowhere, gives it to the government, and they can do and spend it as they want. And then the Fed will sell the treasury bonds in the open market, the bond market, et cetera. And the way, if you've ever heard of yield, you know, and they'll say like right now, in fact, because of what's going on in Europe, there's the Italian banks are pretty much, they're all toast. They're about to have a bailout and a bail-in. The whole financial system or the whole bond market in Europe completely is negative. And this is what I mean by negative, okay? If you remember back when we were younger, you know, maybe grandma or whatever would buy us a U.S. savings bond.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Say it's a $1,000 bond, 10 years or 30 years, doesn't matter. We'll say it's a 10-year $1,000 bond.
Right. You wait 10 years and you get the 1,000, but if you turn it in earlier, you get less.
Well, you're right. Here's what it is. When you buy the bond, you'll take a look at what the yield percentage is. And back in the 80s, when Paul Volcker shot interest rates up 17%, heck, you were making money by buying bonds because you were getting like 11 to 13% return. It was a great way to save money. You didn't have to get in the stock market. You get 13% return just by buying bonds. So anyway, when you buy a bond, say $1,000, and say let's just say it's 3% yield, you pay 97% of that bond. Okay, so what's that? $3 times 10. So you're going to pay $970 for a $1,000 bond, and if you hold it for 10 years, then the government will give you back $1,000. If you sell it early, then, you know, and they put the interest into the bond, you know, annually. So maybe you keep it for 2 years and you, instead of, we'll say 870, not 897, 870, say you've earned $2.50 worth of interest. So then you could sell the bond back for $872.50, and then somebody else could try to hold it for the maturation of the bond and get the rest of the money. Okay. The problem is that because they've, all the countries, including the U.S., Europe, Japan, they put their interest rates at either zero. For the U.S., it's 0.25, but for the ECB, it's negative. They have negative interest rates. What negative interest rates means is, say you have a 1,000 euro bond with Germany, and their interest rate yield is negative 0.28, which means that you pay full price of the bond, 1,000 euros, and at the end of maturity, 10 years, you get back less money.
Yeah, which is pointless.
Exactly. Now get this. Would anybody buy a bond if you're going to get less money back? Why would you buy a bond? So if nobody's buying bonds, then how are these governments ever going to create money? Well, the only way they do that is if the central banks buy it themselves and keep it. It's called central bank monetization of the currency. Well, if the central bank is monetizing everything and the public is not buying it and keeping it, then you're expanding the monetary supply without a conduit, and you're creating monetary hyperinflation. But the problem is that when the governments are doing this, is they're not able to let the – or what they're doing is they're moving the money either to banks, loaning it to banks, loaning it to corporations, or using it to prop up assets. Well, what is the
– the stock market, of course.
Yeah, but in Vegas, what was the big blow up in 2007?
The housing market.
That's exactly what they're doing, is they're using that monetization to prop up the housing bubble.
Right.
Okay, and we've got another new housing bubble going on. I'll tell you how bad the bond market is in Switzerland. Switzerland, which is supposed to be the banking center of the world, you know, fiscally responsible. Every single bond they have, from the one-month bond to a 50-year, they have a 50-year bond. Their 50-year bond is negative. It's minus 0.0003 negative, but it's still negative for a 50-year bond. Now, think about that. You're going to buy a bond and hold it to maturity of 50 years. How much are you going to lose in your purchasing power for inflation alone?
Right. That's what I was going to say. You're not just going to lose the money. You're also going to lose based on inflation.
If you're getting no return on bonds, you're losing money on bonds. The central banks are having to monetize it, which is creating an inflation that will explode once the velocity of money, once that money starts coming into the general economy. If nobody's going to buy bonds, what's the only asset of value that they can protect their wealth in? Gold and silver. And as you see the bond market go completely negative all across the world, this is one of the biggest reasons why gold and silver are skyrocketing. So you can take a look and watch the bond yields and know that the gold and silver will work in opposition. As the yields get worse, the gold and silver price in relation to your currency will go up. Now, here's something else. It's primarily Britain and the United States that are suppressing the price of gold and silver. Right now in Canada, Japan, Mexico, nearly every other single place in the world, gold and silver is back to its all-time high, or within 5% of its all-time high. We're at 13%. We're still down 36% from the all-time high of $1,940 US dollars per ounce. But everywhere else is back to all-time highs in their currency. So if gold and silver is at the all-time high in all of the currencies but the dollar, what happens when the dollar finally cracks? Then gold will, you know, shoot to the moon. 1940 it'll be a faint memory from a decade ago. And you're going to start seeing $3,000, $5,000, $10,000 gold. Now, the bad part with all of this is going to be is if the dollar cracks and that hyperinflation gets into prices, well, yeah, you're going to have $10,000 gold, but you're not going to enjoy the economy or the country that you're living in, because you're going to be paying $30 for a loaf of bread. You're going to be paying $20 for a gallon of milk. But your dollars are going to be virtually worthless. So unless you have gold and silver as your wealth protection and to protect your purchasing power, then you know you're going to be SOL. And to think that the world's not cracking, just take a look at Venezuela. We saw Greece already 2 years ago. Not Zimbabwe, but I think there's another African nation that's going into hyperinflation. Yeah. I think it's Niger, but I could be wrong. Japan. Japan is toast. Like I said, everything is massively negative interest rates. Nobody is in stocks. The central bank has had to buy assets. Remember how he told you when they print money, if they can't afford to let it get in the general economy because they'll create price inflation, so they keep it into assets. The central bank of Japan owns 50% of all the stocks in the Japanese stock market. And it's the second biggest stock market in the world. So all these things are coming to a front. And when you look in the business news and propaganda is propaganda. They're paid to keep you in stocks. They're not paid to get you to take your money out of the system and buy gold and silver or buy farmland or get it out where you're not consuming it or that they can't control it. That's why you'll never get the truth from the mainstream business media.
Right, of course. I mean, they want you to keep your money in, you know, banks and stocks and all of that stuff.
Exactly. You know, it's do you remember the movie War Games?
Yeah.
When Joshua the computer goes, "Professor Falcon, the only way to win this game is not to play." And that's the absolute truth when it comes to the financial system at this time in history.
Well, that's even like we talked about, even keeping your money in the bank is
yeah.
Stupid.
Like I said,
it's pointless because it's not like, you know, if you were getting 5% interest off your money or something, then okay, that's one thing. But you're not making any money off savings account.
We are at the time during the Great Depression where the great Will Rogers once said, "I'm not interested in a return on my money. I'm interested in a return of my money."
Right. Well, I know it's even gone to that point as well. But what I'm saying is that it's not just that. It's never mind that they might take your money, which is the most important thing. But even looking at it from a point of view, if you don't believe that, why have your money savings in there anyway? Because it's not benefiting you to have your savings in there anyway.
No, you keep money in the bank a minimum amount because of the electronic benefits of banking. Okay. I'm not going to dissuade anybody.
Well, for like a checking or something. I don't.
For checking
I'm talking
or
about
bill pay
savings.
Or things like that. Yeah.
I'm saying savings. For that. Savings, what I'm saying is, don't put your savings in a bank. For your checking and stuff like that and to pay your bills and whatnot and maybe buy a few things here or there, I don't, you know, of course, I do that myself.
You would not believe what some clown who's a money manager for some obscure, not J.P. Morgan or Goldman Sachs, he's from some obscure private money you know, brokerage account. You would not believe what he said on CNBC today. He's sitting there trying to justify buying bank stocks, right? And bank stocks, with all the stock market rise and the bank stocks have been absolutely putrid because they are insolvent. This is what he said. He said, don't look at the numbers. Don't look at their earnings. Banks are giving a dividend yield. They're giving this and this and this. As a matter of fact, for people who have money, you should take your money out of your savings account and buy – don't keep it in the bank. but buy bank stocks. I'm like, what? I couldn't believe it. I mean, my jaw dropped. I found that guy's name. I don't remember where I found, and I sent him a tweet, and I was just ripping him all across the Twitter sphere today.
Did he respond to that at all?
No, no. Of course they don't respond.
Yeah, I mean, that's to me, you're better off, although, you know, I lost money this way, but you're better off just gambling, literally. Look, gambling on,
you gotta remember this,
or gambling on sports games.
You never, this is about wealth protection. This is not about investing. If you want to invest, well, I can give suggestions of what I would do, but I can't tell you what to do. If you want pure wealth protection, that's gonna help you in whatever monetary system comes, you're gonna want to get into gold. Now, obviously, gold is getting unaffordable for a lot of people, but there are avenues to do it.
Well, you can buy smaller amounts, though, too. Yeah. You don't have to buy a whole ounce. You can buy, because I bought them before. I bought, you know, a tenth of an ounce. I bought a quarter ounce. So you don't have to buy. You can even buy grams.
Well, that's
of,
just it.
Gold.
The company that I'm with, and you've talked about a number of times, Carrot Bars, they originally started out with you could purchase 1 to 5 grams, a 1 gram, 2.5 gram, or 5 gram. Now they've broken it down into 1/10 of a gram. Okay, so if a gram costs about $60 to $70 with the price rise, whatever, then 1/10 of a gram is like $6 to $10, and you can start your savings doing that.
Yeah, that's the smallest I've heard of.
Yeah, 10 grams. So, but the other side of the coin is, if you wealth protection, it's going to go up. You know, gold is going to go up. It's already broken through the resistance. There is nothing in the financial system that says that it's going to be fixed. It's going to be band-aid over. But you know what? When they started QE in 2011, gold went to 1940. Okay, if the banks, which they're going to have to do, is massive QE, then that's good for gold. If the dollar, which is relatively strong now, devalues, that's good for gold, because when gold was rising up to its all-time high, the dollar was falling on the index from about 97 down to 76, is what it got at the height of the Great Recession. Right now it's at about 94.95. So if the dollar falls, that's great for gold. If the central banks print money, have to print QE, that's great for gold. There's just about every single scenario right now that is great for gold and silver, and the fact that people are waking up, and it is less than 1% of people in US and Europe who own gold and silver. Less than 1%. What if 5% decide to buy gold and silver? Okay, that's not happened since we were on a gold standard and people could own gold in 1935 or 1933. That hasn't happened since then. So if 5% of the people suddenly woke up and said, I'm going to get into gold and silver, the price would go to the moon. You know why? Because supply is so short and limited. It is extremely limited. I mean, right now in the COMEX, which is the futures market, $380 million could buy the entire COMEX, and they'd be out of gold. Now, gold is wealth protection, but if you're looking for an investment, silver is going to be the bigger play, primarily because the gold-silver ratio right now is about 66 to 1. Before silver started its rise, it was actually at 80 to 1. The historic level of what it's supposed to be is between 10 and 15 to 1. So,
are you saying 80 to 1 that there's more silver than gold?
It would take 80 ounces of silver to equal 1 ounce of gold.
Oh, okay.
The price disparity.
Right, right.
Okay. But historically, because of the mining, gold, there's for every 1 ounce of gold, there's usually 10 ounces of silver that's mined. So the ratio should be about 10 to 1. That was before silver started being used as an industrial metal in everybody's smartphones and everybody's PCs and in all the solar panels that they're trying to push and all that. Okay, so silver has the potential to one day not only get back to 10 to 1, but maybe go as, you know, as like 8 to 1, 5 to 1, and possibly 1 to 1. So, you know, the return as an investment on silver is far greater than gold right now.
But yeah, it's a lot cheaper to buy, of course, as well. So
right. But gold itself is going to be the long run wealth protection, because silver will take that gold silver ratio down to a certain point, and then it's going to stagnate. While gold is what central banks are buying far more than silver, so at a certain point, when the great currency reset has to come, there's going to be a cry going back to sound money, and that's when they're going to do a gold standard, and they'll have to set a price that's around, you know, to cover the amount of debt and derivatives that are out there. That's where they're going to set the price between, say, anywhere between $15,000 and $50,000 an ounce.
And that's, yeah. And yeah, I remember, you know, buying gold at like $11.50. Well, the spot price was like $11.50. And then, of course, when you buy gold, whoever you buy it from adds on, you know, a percentage, whatever.
By the way, there's an economist and a mathematician who 50, 60 years ago came up with what's called the Dow gold ratio. And, you know, in 1980, the price of gold and the value of the Dow were equal, 1 to 1.
I know in 1980 gold was like $400, I think.
No,
gold got $200.
Gold got up to $870 an ounce.
Was that when it there was some point in the 80s where it was like $400?
Yeah,
I'm not sure when, but because I remember I went through like back, you know, 50 years or something and looked at gold. And how, you know, it went up and down and whatever, which it really.
Yeah, but it went down for one reason. It went down for one reason. Okay. In 1980, when it hit its height and silver was at $49 an ounce, that's when Paul Volcker raised interest rates to the roof. That killed the gold market. Okay. And people just got out of gold and went into bonds.
Right.
Why worry about this, you know, gold frenzy when I can get 11 to 13% return on a bond?
Well, I think I got, to be honest, I got a 50% return because I got a $25, and maybe they'd only sell them at this low, though. But somebody bought me a $50 savings bond. It might have been 20 years, though, and it was worth $50, but they bought it at $25. So it may have been, again, it may have been like 20-year savings bond, but I, for the $25 they paid, I could cash it in at 50 at, I don't
after
remember
like 10 years.
When. I cashed it in early for like $30.
Right.
But,
and that's what I was saying about the yield. It accumulates, you know. So,
but yeah, it does. As each year goes by, you know, it depending on the amount of years, it kind of divides it out and it keeps, you know, going up each year. But yeah, it was, you know, it was a $50 savings bond that cost $25. So, but again, it could have been like 15, 20 years or something like that. But still, I mean, that was definitely.
Yeah, and since inflation back then was 3%, you would have lost 60% of your purchasing power by holding that, you know, for 20 years.
That's crazy. Well, I'm thinking it might have been less. It might have been 10. But, I mean, it was – I know it was a while. It was at least 10 years. But
right. Well, what I was saying about there was a mathematician who came up with the Dow gold ratio.
Right.
Price of gold in relation to the price of the Dow. In 1980, not the 80s, but 1980, the price of gold and the Dow were equal. At about 870 points, $870. Right now, and that ratio has gone up and down.
What was the meaning of that? So what does that mean when they're the same? What does that mean when one's higher?
What it means is that when the gold Dow ratio gets to 1 to 1, it represents the end of the bull market for gold.
So what about
So if somebody, and you know, like I said, this is over 50 years, but and it's waxed and waned that the price of gold and the value of the Dow has done this. If somebody had followed it during the four cycles between 1950 and today, if they had followed the cycles and when the gold ratio got near 1-to-1, sold their gold and bought into the Dow, then they would have made a ton of money because that's when the Dow would, was moving up and gold price was going down. Then when the ratio got, you know, really highly extended, usually about 8-to-1.
Extended which way, though?
Like 8-to-1 where the Dow, you know.
With, say, which say, is higher.
Yeah, in with the Dow.
Okay.
The Dow. Okay. Like in 2001. 2001 gold.
Is that when it went way up? When gold went way up?
Yeah. No, gold was about to start going up. Gold in 2001 was about $245 an ounce. And the Dow, we had just gotten done with the dot-com boom. And the NASDAQ had gotten to 5,000. The Dow had gotten to just over 10,000. So, you know, let me see here.
So when there's a huge difference and gold is a lot lower, it's a good time to buy gold?
Yeah, let me see the ratio back then, okay? At the end of the dot-com boom, and that was sort of an artificially thing, but the Dow gold ratio was 40, okay? In the course of 20 years, it had gone from 1-to-1 to 40-to-1 where the Dow outdid that. At that point, when the dot-com bubble stopped, you started seeing gold then, you know, come back. So that was the time to start buying gold and start selling your stuff in the Dow. In 2007, we reached, you know, peak, or 2008, we reached peak Dow at that time before they started doing QE. And it was 2 years later that in 2011 that we reached the high $1,940 on gold, okay? But the Dow had fallen to 6,600. So now all of a sudden the ratio was – 3.3.
Okay, so what is it now?
Now it is 13. The Dow is at about 17,900 and some odd.
And it's lowering, it's, obviously, gold is at 13.63. As gold goes up.
So it's at 13. And it was far, you know, we're talking if we started the beginning of the year.
The right. Beginning or of even the year, last year, the end of last year, right?
Yeah, the end of last year, before January 1st when gold started moving. So the Dow was about 18,100 at the start of the year, and gold was at it was like 11 to
something.
10:45.
Got that low. Okay.
Yeah. So you had – it was at 17. And once you had that peak, okay, and the turn of the thing, we've now gone from a Dow gold ratio of 17.3 to in just 6 months, 13.3. And it's confirmed the bull market in gold. So this is the time to get out of the Dow, get into gold, and then allow that to get closer and closer and closer to one. And there'll be indicators saying that when the bull market's going to end, probably about 2020. That's really when the bull market's going to end. So you can accumulate gold up into that point when the Dow is going to fall. Gold gets higher. If it gets closer and closer to that 1-to-1 level, that's when you start selling your gold and start buying the Dow again. There were four different cycles since the 1950s where you could have just made a mint following the Dow gold ratio. That's it. That's the only chart. Throw everything else aside. Geopolitical events, QE, whatever. It was almost deadly accurate. So these are why. This is why gold is significant in determining bull markets and bear markets, not only for the metals, but also for the stock markets.
But to me, I mean, gold is the only thing I would buy personally because I want that asset in my hand that's a tangible physical asset, not a false, even stocks. I mean, it's projected worth and it's not real in a sense. It is, but it's not. You know, there are assets that a corporation has, of course, but you're not going to get any of them if you just have general stock anyway. So it's like, to me, a stock might as well be the same with the currency. You know, right. It's not backed by anything. No matter what the value of gold is, or they say gold is, I have a tangible asset right there, no matter what they deem the price to be.
Right. Just remember, you don't think of gold as an investment. Even if the price goes up and you get more dollars for your right. thing, gold will always be like the absolute barometer for purchasing power. So you don't want to just hold gold and silver necessarily for the sake of, I'm going to pass the gold and silver to my whatever. No, you want to find something that you can use it to purchase something tangible.
I think
it's time to buy a house, right. Farm. You know, something that's going to produce for you.
Well,
that's
thinking really- of holding on to long term to just ensure that I don't lose my money.
Right.
That's how I think of it. I don't think of it as, okay, if I buy a bunch of gold today, when I retire, I'm going to make all this money. I feel like I'm not going to lose all this money off inflation or the stocks or whatever. I'm going to retain what I save.
Right, but my point was going back to 1980, as I said.
No, I know what you mean.
When Paul Volcker rose interest rate, you know, did interest rates to stop stagflation, that was a warning signal that, you know, gold is not necessarily the best thing to hold your money in. I would have sold most of my gold and silver, gotten into bonds, and then what I could have done, of course, is as the gold price goes down. You know, as we got to the early 2000s and gold had gone from its high down to 240, well, I would have taken the maturity of my bonds, and then I would have had much more money, and then I would have bought gold at a much lower price, accumulated more. So I am not somebody who says just buy gold and silver with all your money and that's all you're going to ever do. No. It's being smart with recognizing that the fiat currencies that we have out here are all collapsing. The bond markets are all negative. The stock markets are manipulated and they could crash anytime. They've got absolutely low volume. They're being propped up by central banks. The corporations are buying back their own stock, but their earnings are actually atrocious. Now's the time that you want to get out of your dollars into gold and silver to hold, waiting for what's going to occur. Whether the IMF and SDR becomes the next global reserve currency, whether a gold trade note's going to do, if the dollar crashes and they have to do an international dollar for trade and a domestic currency for us to spend, that's what you're going to do. Because just like the 1930s, those who had their wealth protected and didn't lose everything in the stock market crash, didn't lose everything in the foreclosures, they were able to buy assets at pennies on the dollar.
Right.
That's the whole goal about wealth protection, is you find the asset that has minimal amount of risk, gives you a good return, and then you can use that to purchase more assets and grow your wealth. It's a combination of protecting your wealth and growing your wealth. Now we're at a point where you absolutely have to protect it. There's no finding growth because everything is so, you know, bubbled up. Stock markets, housing bubble,
but it,
rents, bond markets all negative. You know, and the reason that bond markets are negative is because everybody's getting into bonds.
It seems like we're at a point where that's not going to change. Like,
no, it will change. You know what? Here's the sad fact. The global financial system collapsed in 2008. It just doesn't know it yet. It's dead. They've been propping it. You know, think of a person who had a brain injury. They're in vegetative state, but the machines are keeping them breathing and keeping.
Well, right.
Them.
That's what
that's
I'm
exactly
saying.
Exactly what it is.
That
at a certain point, they've got to pull the plug.
Right. Well, that's what I'm saying. That it's not gonna change. Meaning, the dollar is gone. Right. I mean, it still exists, but
ever get
exactly. Yeah. That's what I mean.
So we got to prepare for what the new system is going to be.
You know, that's what I mean when I'm saying it's not going to change. Meaning that the current system is gone. So, you know, it's just a matter of time. You know, and they keep doing whatever they can to try to hold on longer and longer and just, you know, a little longer. And they do all these things, of course, in government media to distract people and whatnot from that, because you never hear them talking about those things except on, channels that you do on the business, you know, like they have Fox has their own business channel and CNB, whatever, one of the has a business. And then they tell you to bullshit like you were saying. Besides that, in, you know, the main stories are rarely a lot about the economy. It's just the stock price, you know, and oh, that's great. The stock market's great. And that's about it. But let's take a quick break. And when we come back, I wanted to talk about the EU and where that's going, and then any other stories you have, and then we can wrap up. So go and check out Ken at thedailyeconomist.com. A lot of important stories there. And we'll be back after this. I don't know what I should call it, because it's not a commercial and it's not a message. After this important message, I guess, that is not an advertisement, but it is important to know. And check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. We will be right back.
When should you shoot a cop? That question, even without an answer, makes most law-abiding taxpayers go into knee-jerk conniptions. The indoctrinated masses all race to see who can be first and loudest to proclaim that it is never okay to forcibly resist law enforcement. In doing so, they also inadvertently demonstrate why so much of human history has been plagued by tyranny and oppression. In an ideal world, cops would do nothing except protect people from thieves and attackers, in which case shooting a cop would never be justified. In the real world, however, far more injustice, violence, torture, theft, and outright murder has been committed in the name of law enforcement than has been committed in spite of it. To get a little perspective, try watching a documentary or two about some of the atrocities committed by the regimes of Stalin or Lenin or Chairman Mao, or Hitler, or Pol Pot, or any number of other tyrants in history. Pause the film when the jackboots are just about to herd innocent people into the cattle cars, or just about to gun them down as they stand on the edge of a ditch, and then ask yourself the question, when should you shoot a cop? Keep in mind, the evils of those regimes were committed in the name of law. And as much as the statement may make people cringe, the history of the human race would have been a lot less gruesome if there had been a lot more cop killers around to deal with the state mercenaries of those regimes. Now, people don't mind when you point out the tyranny that has happened in other countries, but most have a hard time viewing their own country, their own government, and their own law enforcers in any sort of objective way. Having been trained to feel a blind loyalty to the ruling class of the particular piece of dirt they live on, also known as patriotism, and having been trained to believe that obedience is a virtue, the idea of forcibly resisting law enforcement is simply unthinkable to many. Literally, they can't even think about it. And humanity has suffered horribly because of it. It is a testament to the effectiveness of authoritarian indoctrination that literally billions of people throughout history have begged and screamed and cried in the face of authoritarian injustice and oppression, but only a tiny fraction have ever actually lifted a finger to try to stop it. Even when people can recognize tyranny and oppression, they still usually talk about working within the system, the same system that's responsible for the tyranny and the oppression. People want to believe that the system will, sooner or later, provide justice. The last thing they want to consider is that they should illegally resist, that if they want to achieve justice, they must become criminals and terrorists, which is what anyone who resists legal injustice is automatically labeled. But history shows all too well that those who fight for freedom and justice almost always do so illegally, i.e., without the permission of the ruling class. If politicians think that they have the right to impose any law they want, and cops have the attitude that as long as it's called law, they will enforce it, what is there to prevent complete tyranny? Not the consciences of the lawmakers or their hired thugs, obviously, and not any election or petition to the politicians. When tyrants define what counts as law, then by definition, it is up to the lawbreakers to combat tyranny. Pick any example of abuse of power, whether it's the fascist so-called war on drugs, the police thuggery that has become so common, the random stops and searches now routinely carried out in the name of security, such as at airports, border checkpoints that aren't even at the border, sobriety checkpoints, and so on, or any other example. Now ask yourself the uncomfortable question. If it's wrong for cops to do these things, doesn't that imply that the people have a right to resist such actions? And of course, state mercenaries don't take kindly to being resisted, even non-violently. If you question their right to detain you, interrogate you, search you, invade your home, and so on, you are very likely to be tasered, physically assaulted, kidnapped, put in a cage, or shot. If a cop decides to treat you like livestock, whether he does it legally or not, you will usually have only two options: submit or kill the cop. You can't resist a cop just a little and get away with it. He will always call in more of his fellow gang members until you are subdued or dead. Basic logic dictates that you either have an obligation to let law enforcers have their way with you, or you have the right to stop them from doing so, which will almost always require killing them. Politely asking fascists to not be fascists has a very poor track record throughout history. Consider the recent Indiana Supreme Court ruling, which declared that if a cop tries to illegally enter your home, it's against the law for you to do anything to stop him. Aside from the patent absurdity of it, since it amounts to giving thugs with badges permission to break the law and makes it a crime for you to defend yourself against a criminal if he has a badge, consider the logical ramifications of that attitude. There were once some words written on a piece of parchment, those words now known as the Fourth Amendment, that said that you have the right to be free from unreasonable searches and seizures at the hands of government agents. In Indiana today, what could that possibly mean? The message from the ruling class is quite clear and utterly insane. It amounts to this: we don't have the right to invade your home without probable cause, but if we do, you have no right to stop us, and we have the right to arrest you if you try. Why not apply that to the rest of the Bill of Rights while we're at it? You have the right to say what you want, but if we use violence to shut you up, you have to let us. I can personally attest to the fact that that is the attitude of the U.S. so-called Department of Justice. Or maybe, you have the right to have guns, but if we try to forcibly and illegally disarm you and you resist, we have the right to kill you. Ask Randy Weaver or the Branch Davidians about that one. You have the right to not testify against yourself, but when we coerce you into confessing and call it a plea agreement, you can't do a thing about it. What good is a right? What does the term right even mean if you have an obligation to allow jackboots to violate your so-called rights? it makes the term absolutely meaningless. To be blunt, if you have the right to do A, it means that if someone tries to stop you from doing A, even if he has a badge and a politician's scribble, sometimes called law, on his side, you have the right to use whatever amount of force is necessary to resist that person. That's what it means to have an unalienable right. If you have the unalienable right to speak your mind, a la the First Amendment, then if all else fails, you have the right to kill government agents who try to shut you up. If you have the unalienable right to be armed, then if all else fails, you have the right to kill government agents who try to disarm you. If you have the right to not be subjected to unreasonable searches and seizures, then if all else fails, you have the right to kill government agents who try to inflict those upon you. Those who are proud to be law-abiding don't like to hear this and don't like to think about this, but what's the alternative? If you do not have the right to forcibly resist so-called legal injustice, that logically implies that you have an obligation to allow government agents to do absolutely anything they want to you, your home, your family, your neighbors, and so on. Really, there are only two choices. You are a slave, the property of the politicians without any rights at all, or you have the right to violently resist government attempts to oppress you. There can be no other option. Of course, on a practical level, openly resisting the gang called government is usually very hazardous to one's health. But there's a big difference between obeying for the sake of self-preservation, which is often necessary and rational, and feeling a moral obligation to go along with whatever the ruling class wants to do to you, which is pathetic and insane. Most of the incomprehensible atrocities that have occurred throughout history were due in large part to the fact that most people answer never to the question of when should you shoot a cop. The correct answer is, when evil is legal, become a criminal. When oppression is enacted as law, become a lawbreaker. And when those violently victimizing the innocent have badges, become a cop killer. So the next time you hear of a police officer being killed in the line of duty, take a moment to consider the very real possibility that maybe in that case, the law enforcer was the bad guy and the cop killer was the good guy. As it happens, that has been the case more often than not throughout human history.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in. Username, Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. That's actually one of my favorite clips that I play from Larkin Rose, which a lot of things that he has done, I agree with. I essentially had those thoughts prior to, I'm not talking about this specifically, that clip, but a lot of the things I agree with prior to actually even hearing Larkin Rose. But he explains it so much better and so much more. He's more articulate, obviously, and it explains it in a much more understandable way. But anyway, we are here today with Ken Schortgen of The Daily Economist, and we have been talking about gold. One of the reasons, of course, gold went up was the exit of Britain from the European Union, among other things. But when does that officially happen? I know they had a vote on it. And then is there a specific date, and can they back out of it?
Now, I'm sorry, what was that again?
When does Britain's exit officially happen?
It's gonna take a little while. It could take between 6 months and 2 years.
So can they back out of it in between that time, and are they liable? Like, I know one of the reasons is because everybody else, you know, the euro's crashing, like you were saying, and you have all these countries that are going to be need to be bailed out, like you had mentioned Italy and, of course, Greece.
Well, they could back out, but chances are extremely extremely against it. The reason why, the day that the Brexit vote took place and the Leave won it, David Cameron, the prime minister,
resigned
the very next day.
And this is something that the people want, not that, and that's why he resigned, I would assume, it as well as he, you know, he's down, a globalist. And
I think deep down also, okay, the powers that be, the central banks and the whole cabal establishment didn't want it to happen because they are so desperate to make the European Union work because it's their model of globalism.
Right, right.
If we get it to work here, we can get it to work well.
Yep.
Okay, but they also are not stupid. They know exactly the state of the global financial system. So guess what? By doing Brexit, now they have an excuse. Okay? When the system starts to crash, which it already is, but when it comes big time, when we have that Lehman moment, then they're going to point at Brexit. See, the British caused this to happen. Had the British not left, us central bankers, we were holding the system fine. So they're using his excuse, and they're probably thankful because, look at everything tip over. Britain leaving the European Union accounts for absolutely nothing.
What do you mean by that?
They can decide not to readjust the trade agreements. They can decide not to readjust the.
Oh, okay. So they can keep everything the same.
There's only two things that really the British exit affects the European Union. First, no longer open borders. Okay. In the European Union, everybody who is a full member,
you can travel freely in those countries.
Somebody from Czechoslovakia, if they wanted a job in Britain, could go right in, not have to go through immigration, whatever. Their passport worked, and they get a job and work and live in Britain. A British person could go to France, could go to Germany. That was the full autonomy of the European Union. Now, also what it does is it means that the agenda of the Brussels unelected government that runs the EU, they can't force all these refugees into Britain anymore.
But does that start now or does that start later?
It's relative because the British representative at the EU Parliament, the world-famous Nigel Farage, you may have seen some of his videos.
I've heard of him, but
he's the British version of Ron Paul.
I think I have actually seen some interviews with him.
Yeah, he's already – the Brits are pretty much out of the Parliament. They aren't even allowed to speak. They don't vote. They don't do anything. So the EU has already said, already come to the realization that they're gone. What needs to happen is that David Cameron is planning on leaving in September, and they're already the Conservatives, the Tories, the Labour parties are already working their candidates up to decide who's going to replace the prime minister.
Yeah, what do they do in England when a prime minister leaves? Like, of course, if it was the U.S., the vice president would take over. What do they do in England? Do they have another election?
Well, they have an election amongst the ruling parties. Remember this. Britain is a parliament. Parliament, right. unlike the United States, which just has two political parties and a few independents that,
Like one. Who's not really an independent.
Bernie Sanders is independent.
Not really, but.
Yeah, well, he votes mostly with the Democrats.
The Democrats, right. He's a socialist Democrat, supposedly. Yeah. Right.
So anyway, there will probably be about five different political parties that get seats in the British Parliament. Now, what that means is that very rarely does one single political party have the 50% majority to automatically control. They have to create a coalition. So the Tories, which is what the Conservative Party, the equivalent of the Republicans, David Cameron's last election, they got that supermajority. They won 60% of the parliament seats. So automatically, you're going to have a Tory be the prime minister until the next general election. Okay.
So it's going to be the actual parliament, the party, that party in the parliament are going to be the ones that vote
exactly.
for president? Okay.
Exactly. They'll nominate and they'll just assign them prime minister.
And then the Tories
have the majority. They're well over 50% because of the last election.
So that's until his term would have been normally up.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. And then they have general election, and say Labor Party gets 45%, and they hook up with the Green Party, and they form a coalition that's more than 50%. Then the Labor Party would put a candidate for prime minister.
Yeah, that sounds kind of stupid, but okay.
Well, you know, to each their own.
But a lot of stuff in the U.S. government. So,
well, whatever. You know, if you think about the three different main political parties, there is, the Democrats and Republicans in the United States. There is five or six that are part of Britain. There are one that's in China.
Well, what happens in an emergency, though, that, you know, the prime minister dies? I mean, do they have a secession?
No. Here's what they're doing now. The Tory party has more than 50%, so they automatically will nominate and appoint.
Right, but they have time. So what I'm saying is, if he died, where you know, he's leaving, so they have time, you know what I mean? Where he resigned.
They don't have a secondary guy.
So if the prime minister dies, what do? They just don't have a prime minister until they have an election?
No, hold on. You didn't let me finish.
Sorry, go ahead.
It's not an election.
No, I know. It's an election by the Tory party itself, right.
It's the equivalent of the primary.
It's a nomination by that party.
Bingo. It's equivalent of a primary. All the Tory representatives in Parliament will get together and they'll vote for one of their members to be prime minister.
So they would do that in a day instead of doing it in a couple months is what...
Correct. But it wouldn't be exactly a day. It would be a person has to get 50% or more of the vote amongst the parliamentarians of their party. Right now, there are five people that are being put up for the next prime minister. The top person, a woman who is extremely anti-Euro and anti-EU. So she said, if I get appointed to this office, we're starting Article 50. And Article 50 is what you apply to the EU to leave it. Okay. We're starting Article 50 now. So she has, I think, 36% of the first ballot vote in the primary, and then the second person has like 17%, and the third person.
So it's a process that will take a little while.
Yeah, probably take about 2 weeks.
Oh, okay. So
they have the first ballot, and then what happens is that there's parliamentarians get together and start haggling and start making deals. And a couple people drop off and they have a runoff. And once they get down to the final two candidates, then they'll have the runoff. One will get 50% or more and the other won't. That becomes the prime minister. So this is the first ballot. There's five people in the Tory party that are part of it. That's going to whittle down to the last two. They'll have a runoff. Boom.
If the prime minister just died, it would be like a two-week process.
Yeah.
So they wouldn't have a prime minister for a couple weeks until they went through the process.
And you got to remember, there is still an ultimate leadership if the prime minister is not there. It's called the crown.
I was going to, yeah.
Yeah, so say they
that, but,
can
I,
fit in.
But I thought, that see, that's fucked up in itself.
It would be a temporary thing. They're not going to seize power back again.
The queen's going to
The Magna Carta still reigns supreme, but it would be a temporary thing. You know, there have been prime ministers who have just resigned on a day. If you remember World War II, who was that? Chamberlain. Yeah, you know, he got... After Hitler invaded Poland, after Chamberlain had thought that Hitler was going to stop his thing, he just resigned in a day. It took a few days, and Winston Churchill won the runoff ballot. So,
yeah, yep. I mean, I don't think it's a big deal not to have a, you know, well, I don't think it's a big deal not to have a leader permanently. So, what does it matter for a couple weeks?
Think about this. You know, if if a congressman dies or resigns in office, the states have a choice. They can appoint a temporary – what they do is they normally appoint a temporary representative or congressman until they can get the time for a runoff election. Right. So there have been instances where like John Boehner. John Boehner resigned. And they put somebody in his place from Ohio. And I think last fall
– until they have an election.
They had a quick election. Usually those type of elections take about 3 months.
But that doesn't – a lot of times you don't even have people that vote. So it's like it doesn't even matter.
You don't have people vote for anything anymore, 40% at the most. And it's even less during midterm elections. So, yeah. Imagine if 70% of Americans, eligible Americans, voted.
Well, no, I was talking about the House and the Senate. You have people that don't vote a lot of the time. I mean, they need a certain amount, but they don't need 100%. So a lot of times you'll have – I know Rubio missed tons of votes.
Yeah, exactly.
Especially when he was running for president. But, you'll have people that miss votes all the time, and it just goes on. So even if somebody didn't have a representative in there, doesn't really even matter. I mean, it might matter to them, but to that state. But
by the way, there's some interesting things about Brexit. One of the reasons why people are believing that the Brexit vote actually came through is because just like 100 years ago, one of the reasons behind the start of World War I and the killing of the Archduke Ferdinand of Austria-Hungary.
Well, the reason they give as to why it started World War One,
right? But the purpose even behind shooting him was there was a massive wave of nationalism and the ending of empire. Okay, Austro-Hungarian Empire was full of a bunch of different nationalities. Serbia didn't have its own land. Poland, Poles, Czechs, whole whatever. And there was a rising crescendo to break up, the same thing with the Ottoman Empire. There was a rising crescendo to break up these things and bring nationalism. So 100 years later, we are in what is considered a frequency change. This is why Bernie Sanders and anti-establishment candidates like Donald Trump have suddenly, and this did not start here. If you remember, do you remember what the first real anti-establishment rally was about 5 years ago? It was Occupy Wall Street. People after the bailouts, got together and said, you know what, against the establishment, against the one percenters that started the class division. And that was tamped down and sort of.
And then Obama got elected. Yeah. he got elected, and then that kind of toned that down.
Right. But what was the next thing to rise up?
The Tea Party, right?
The Tea Party.
Because then you had Obama in there, and then they're like, hey, we. Well, they actually formed before that, but it was towards the end of Bush, but then it ramped up.
If Occupy Wall Street was the progressives' way of going against the establishment, Tea Party was the conservatives' way of going against the establishment.
Right, and they all got hijacked by the establishment anyway, exactly. In the end.
So that sort of fell by the wayside, even though there are a few
Tea Party candidates, like Ted Cruz or whatever.
That are in Congress right now. I mean, not the Ted Cruz, but real ones. There's a few.
They say Mike Lee. Who's the other guy? Another guy from Texas.
The guy who took out Eric Cantor from Virginia was a Tea Party candidate. And Eric Cantor was the Senate Majority Whip.
Yeah, so, he was a douchebag because
he was the House Majority Whip. So
he was also the one who came out and said when the police, and you probably agree with this, but when the police shot that woman with her baby in her car down the street from the White House where they had a big car chase, and then she stopped, and then they put like fucking 20 bullets in her car, the Secret Service and the D.C. police. But that's a whole nother issue. But he came out and congratulated. Oh, they protect us so well.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, after the Tea Party sort of floundered along, what came next? the Ron Paul Revolution. And the Ron Paul Revolution was going to
because Ron Paul ran. I mean, Ron Paul's been around a long time. I know he didn't get the following, but Ron Paul was kind of. I mean, Ron Paul was really the original Tea Party, sort of.
Yeah, but he didn't. You know, he didn't.
Not the Tea Party now, but like the.
He never really joined the Tea Party, but he did speak up for many planks in the platform that the Tea Party stood for.
Because he was kind of around the same. Because 2008 was where really when he got that popularity. I mean, he'd been running since like 88. I remember I saw an interview. Yeah, I saw when he ran as a libertarian and speeches and stuff that he made. And I actually liked him better back then when I go back and not when I was a kid back then. But I mean, when I look at what he said back then now, he seemed more libertarian back then, to be honest.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, he's been around for a while. But it was 2008. Where everybody kind of got on that Ron Paul, train there. But
that's where they started.
But the Tea Party kind of started at the same time. Yeah,
yeah. He ran for the presidency or the Republican candidacy in 2012.
Yeah,
and, he ran and the Republican Party changed a number of rules to keep him from getting. So what I'm saying is that there's an old saying by John F. Kennedy that says. If you make
revolution
impossible,
violent revolution is inevitable.
Inevitable. Right. This is what happens. They tamped down on the Occupy Wall Street instead of addressing the needs of the people. They tamped down the Tea Party and they co-opted it. They cheated done it with from primary things.
They've done it with the police too, where they've hijacked any real police movement and with these bullshit. Movements that are run by Democratic operatives and shit like that. They've hijacked any real police movement that is really about whether it's body cams or changing the rights of the police or as a whole, not as a just a black issue or whatever. So they've hijacked that too.
Right.
There were people that were coming together to actually protest police. But they hijacked it the same way everything else gets hijacked.
But the point of all of this is, okay, is it's a universal frequency thing. Have you ever been in a situation, like deja vu, whatever, that you feel something is happening, but you just can't put your finger on it, and it's a movement, whether it's the 1960s and the hippie movement and the change. This is what's happening: is the frequency change, and the establishment is
and now Trump is the movement.
And
is that what you're going to tell me?
People really don't like Trump.
I can't stand him.
They hate the establishment so much that they're willing to put him up because he is against the establishment. We could have had better candidates.
So he says.
Well,
of course he wasn't. When a couple years ago. But all of a sudden,
but it's not a matter of whether he is or isn't. People are willing to go outside the box because they were not addressed in 2009, 2010 when Occupy Wall Street started, and they weren't addressed at the Tea Party.
They're never going to be addressed.
Because the establishment is now at a point, just like in 1916, 1918, where the world went to war. Things are changing, and you can't control it.
Okay? Well, that's where they got to pull something. Yeah, but the government now is so fucked up, in my opinion, that they will pull something, and you mentioned war, like a war, maybe with the shit with ISIS or whatever, that they'll pull something to try to bring the country together, whether it's a false flag, whether it's a war.
They will try, but think about this. In the Orlando shooting, only a small amount of people actually believed that it was a lone wolf guy.
There's no way that one guy shot,
Bingo.
I have an AR-15, I've shot it a bunch of times, and there's no way one guy hit 100 shots, made 100 shots. There's no fucking way.
San Bernardino. Nobody believes that that's a single, you know, two Arab Islamic.
Well, that was not that many people that got killed. That might have been just a crazy lunatic. I don't believe that was fake or anything, but I don't believe that. It's 3 hours too. This unaccounted for 3 hours. I believe possibly that the SWAT team fucking killed like 20 people. Maybe by accident, maybe on purpose.
Me tell you something. I don't know if it was San Bernardino. No, it was Paris. Remember the Paris attacks?
Yeah, where they came in with machine guns. Of course, they got gun laws there that banned guns, but they still brought them in somehow.
Think about this. There was a woman there who was on vacation. She was from Mexico. She was in the police, one of the police headquarters there. She called her family at a certain time, right? And said, "Yeah, somebody's shooting up the you know."
There were like four spots or something that they shot up, I believe, in Paris.
12 hours later, that woman was dead, and her body was found in the dance hall. Now she had already been in the police station after the shooting had been taken, but there were a group of people
that killed them,
and then they put their bodies in to try to justify the false flag. Okay, yes, they're doing it, but. People, you know, you can only go to cry wolf so many times. Let me give you an example of this. There's a couple things with Brexit that are very fascinating. Do you remember hearing about the British parliamentarian Joe Cox, who was stabbed and then shot about a week before the Brexit vote?
No, I must have missed that.
Yeah, there was a British equivalent of congressman, parliamentarian. Okay. Who was out in the market and
shot. Did he live?
This lunatic. No, it was a female. Cox.
Jill. Did she live?
Joe. Cox.
It is Joe, but it's Joe, a girl. Okay. Well, right. Did she live?
No. No, this lunatic who started screaming,
Muslim shit.
You're against the Brexit. And he stabbed her, and she was living, and then he pulled out a gun, an antique gun from his grandfather or whatever, because they can't have guns there or whatever, and shot her. Okay? Now, why is this significant? Immediately after, or when Joe Cox was killed like that, the polls had showed that the Leave vote. This was a week before the referendum. The Leave vote was up by like 17 points. After Joe Cox is killed,
it went down.
David Cameron comes out and says, "We're going to suspend campaign for a few days, you know, whatever." When the polls came back, the polls showed that the state Remain suddenly was in the lead.
That's fucked up.
Wall Street and everybody else thought that it's in the bag. You know, they can rig the election, yeah. And they've already got this. So the stock market went up like 400 points over the next 2 days going into the weekend. Well, guess what? The vote came out, and I mean, it was 52-48. It was full 4%. That's why they knew that they couldn't rig it. It was well into the Leave camp. Well, here's something interesting. Like I said, Joe Cox killed 1 week before the vote when the Leave was up in the polls. In 2003, Sweden was in the process of voting whether to move into the euro currency. They were already in the EU, but they were going to go to the euro currency. And leading up to that vote, the nays against going to the euro were slightly ahead. And for all intents and purposes, it appeared the decision to keep their own currency would succeed. Then out of nowhere, a pro-euro female politician, Anna Lindh, was brutally murdered in a public market, which not only caused the government to suspend debate on the euro issue for a short amount of time, but facilitated the people to change from rejecting the euro to suddenly being willing to accept it.
So they use the same exact same things over and over again. Yeah, they tended to use even the exact – you could tell like that they don't even change it up anymore. They just don't even give a fuck. But that's all the time we have for tonight. I'd like to thank Ken Schortgen again for joining us. Go to the Daily Economist. But that's a good point. And that's why I say like all elections are rigged. And I say that not in the ballot box. They do things to rig elections. A lot of times between media and political parties, they don't have to kill people in the U.S. People are so ignorant that they have other ways to rig them. But they use the same things over and over again. So people should be aware of that. But a lot of people are just in denial. Oh, that doesn't happen. No, it doesn't happen. Or it happens, but not in the United States or whatever. So, but we'll be back tomorrow. Thanks, everybody, for tuning in. And again, check out Ken's website, The Daily Economist, at thedailyeconomist.com. And check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. Thanks, everybody, for tuning in. See you tomorrow.
Listen to police officers' commands. Listen to what we tell you and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.